Good morning, everybody. Our first speaker this morning is going to speak on organic commodities, give an organic commodities market update. His name's Ryan Koory with Mercaris, and I'll turn things over to him.
Thank you. Good morning, everyone. My name's Ryan Koory, as I said. I'm with Mercaris, and this morning I'm going to run you through basically the landscape of the organic commodity market as I see it as we're moving into this 2020 year. I'm going to start off with some high-level themes in terms of what I kind of see in the industry in the broader sense, and then I'm going to dive down and I'll go into some specific crop stuff. As I go through this, I'm an economist, so I'm going to show you a whole bunch of numbers. So slow me down, stop me, ask me questions at any time if you have any questions, because if you wait to the end, you'll all be asleep because these things are pretty boring. So the first thing I want to talk about is just the general scale of what we're looking at right now for organic field crops in the United States. The positive news is we continue to see growth. These numbers here are a little bit weird because one of the difficulties we have in the organic sector is we just don't have great data records. So, as you can tell, the number of certified organic operations that it captured are significantly lower than what we captured. What we do is we take what's reported in the OID. So every year that you guys fill out your certification plan, it gets submitted to the USDA, that goes to the National Organics Program, and there's a data bank that captures how many organic farms there are in the United States. So overall though, the big story that this graph here tells you is even with that jump off point, we continue to see the number of organic acres in the United States grow. And the number of acres are growing at a faster rate than the overall number of farms. So that tells us two things. One, we're having more farmers move into the space. Two, people who have transitioned are transitioning more acres in, so the number of acres per farm has grown. So from two different directions, we see the organic industry is growing. So that's positive. The next one I like to pick on is, what do things look like from the demand side? Now, the OTA puts out a survey every year for what expenditures look like in the organic sector. And the big number from this past year is that organic food sales reached $48 billion, I think is what that is, which is great. One of the things that's a problem, though, that number doesn't really address is, what does that rate of growth look like, and what does that rate of growth look like relative to total food sales? Well, if you take the USDA numbers for total food sales, and you compare that $48 billion from the OTA, we're at about 3% of total food sales for organic food. Which, that's up from where we were about 10 years ago, but it's only up by about 1%. So the overall rate of growth actually isn't that heroic. And if you take that 3% and you consider even if we reach 6%, we double sales, we're still not even at 10%. You could add another 3%, you're only at 9%. There's a huge amount of potential for penetration within the food sector right now in terms of expanding the industry sales. The downside is, though, if you look at the past 3 years, the rate of growth has slowed substantially. We're plateauing at about 3% of sales. So this is something I think that is an extremely important point for everybody in the organic industry to consider moving forward. If you want to continue to get $8 for corn, $20 for beans, you can't stay at 3% of food sales. Acres are going to catch up the demand, and you're going to start to see premiums fall. This right here is a widow maker for the industry in the making. If this does not continue to grow, if we don't see this thing hit 6%, 10% in the next 5 to 10 years, you're going to see margins fall substantially. It's an extremely important thing. The other thing I like to harp on is the actual breakouts in terms of where the sales are growing. And you can see we've got good growth in things like bread and grain and beverages and snack foods. Fruits and vegetables continue on a good path, but that's not really extremely relevant to grain producers. The places that this actually matters the most, though, is meat and poultry, eggs and dairy. And the reason for that is that's where you see the most value add pass through in the organic and the commodity sector. If you get to a loaf of bread or a granola bar, there's a lot of packaging and processing and things like that, value add that occur, that dilute how much of that growth gets passed down into commodity prices. It's not the same for meat and dairy, though, because when you feed a chicken, you feed a cow, and it goes into milk, that's pretty much it. You put it in a package and it gets sold. There's less value add. So looking at the rate of growth on those guys tells you a whole lot of stuff. The first thing you can see is looking at dairy, and this is probably not a surprise to anyone. Over 2018, organic dairy sales fell. And really what that is that demand problem. And dairy's hitting the same thing that the conventional sector has. It's the fact that fluid milk sales aren't expanding. If you go to the store to buy organic dairy milk, you're competing with oat milk, you're competing with soy milk. The people who are going to buy organic milk are buying non-animal-based dairy products. And so that's why we're seeing that number struggle so much. What the organic industry needs to focus on there is moving into other value-add products, more artisanal cheeses, moving into dairy derivatives like non-fat dry for organic baby foods and organic formulas, those types of things. But those things are extremely capital intensive and expensive to move into. So we're not moving into there very fast. And as a result, you see the dairy segment is plateauing. The next one is eggs. Eggs are really important. You're up 9% in sales, so that's fantastic. We want to see that number continue to grow because that's a major sector of demand for the organic industry. The last one, meat, poultry, and fish. It's pretty much just broilers and turkeys. As you guys know, organic beef is almost impossible to do on any kind of major scale. And organic pork, it's growing, but it's still very small. It makes up a very small portion of that pool. So you're really talking about broilers and eggs, or broilers and turkeys rather. So 11% growth, you know, between that and eggs, it's really the poultry sector that's leading that feed demand pocket. Nobody's asked any questions. You guys got to ask questions because I'll burn through these too fast and you guys will fall asleep on me.
What do you see as the flattening, why is the flattening of the sales curve?
My opinion, you know, the number one thing that I see whenever I speak to people, his question was, why do I see this flattening in that sales curve? I think what that is, if you talk to somebody, the average consumer on the market, and you say, what's the difference between organic and non-GMO? What's the difference between organic and natural? They don't understand the entire benefit that is supposed to be encapsulated in that brand. Because really, when you're looking at food sales in the US, you're talking about market share. Population is not growing that much, and we're not eating that much more per person. So you're talking about capturing market share. And in capturing market share, what you're trying to do is create a premium brand. Why should I pick you over the other guy on the shelf? Well, organic is a premium brand. That's why people are like Purdue and the Smithfields are moving into that sector, because it's impossible to grow domestic chicken consumption almost. You're trying to take consumption from your competitor. If you look at organic as a premium brand, it's important to translate every single one of those items in that bundle of good and to have your consumers understand those goods so that they fully internalize the value of that. If not, then what's to keep them from picking something else on the shelf? And so I think that's what we're seeing. Is you've seen the early adopters, they've moved in, but continuing to strengthen that message and to translate that message to consumers so that they understand why it is that you should buy organic, it looks like it's slipping. Taking those livestock numbers and trying to put them around some sense of what feed demand might look like as a result. Well, in 2018, we saw organic broiler and turkey production sales go up about 11%. And that's pretty consistent with what we've seen in terms of actual inventory growth in terms of the number of birds being slaughtered. What happened in 2019, though, is we saw that number slow down significantly. And actually, I think we ended down about 1% year over year on broiler slaughter for the organic sector, which is another negative sign. If you've got dairy is plateauing, broilers are plateauing, that's your two major pockets of feed demand right there that have slowed down. Eggs continue to look positive, and actually turkey's picking up the pace. All in all though, you know, if I had to take coming out of last year into this year and talking about where I think our rate of growth is gonna be on our livestock inventories and put that into a feed demand concept, I think you're looking at about 2% more feed demand this year than what you had last year, which is still more demand, which is good. But if you consider the fact, if you're coming out of 2017, you're looking at about 5 to 6%. And I think 16 was about 8%. 18 was somewhere around 4%. We're slowing down. That growth rate on feed demand is slowing down. And again, as a grain farmer, that is one, or organic grain farmer, that is the lion's share of your demand pool. Most organic grain goes into livestock feed. So seeing those numbers grow and grow at a robust pace is extremely important for that demand picture. And that demand picture is extremely important for those premiums. So it all comes back around to demand. Now, one thing everybody likes to hear about or hates to hear about is imports. Looking at the import picture, one of the things I like to convey is it's too simple to talk about imports as imports. when you're talking about imports, it's become complicated, and there's lots of different things going on. And that's pretty well highlighted if you just look at the difference between corn and soybeans. If you look at what's going on with organic corn imports, they ticked back up a little bit last year, but the general trend we've seen for the past 5 years is, number one, imports are declining, and they're declining as a share of our domestic supply. Soybeans are a completely different story. Not only are they growing, but they're growing as a share of domestic supply. The reason these things look very different is there's very different realities in terms of the production and in terms of the markets for those two crops. And as a result, you're seeing a huge divergence in terms of what's going on the import side. If you talk about corn, 28%, you know, frankly, we could probably do that as an industry. We could ratchet up organic corn acres 28% in the next 2 years, frankly, and squash that. We wouldn't need organic corn imports. You ratchet up organic soybean acres to cover that 76%, that is basically tripling current organic soybean acres. That's a totally different story. That's not feasible. So when you talk about imports, it's really important to differentiate exactly which markets you're talking about and exactly what's going on in those markets. And I'll go into some deeper details on the imports later. Yeah, yeah. So, you know, I would say that for corn, what you're talking about, so her question is, when you're talking about corn imports, are you talking about import prices squashing domestic production, or are you just talking about not being able to produce enough? And so I think when you're talking about corn, what you're talking about is more the latter, the fact that we haven't been able to scale up production fast enough to keep up with that ratchet up and poultry demand is really what you're talking about there. And if you look at the two commodities, corn and soybeans, imports are underpriced to the domestic on both accounts, right? But that underpriced paradigm has not stopped us from reducing that dependency on corn imports. It doesn't seem to be helping on soybeans. So if it was simply a price situation, why would you see such a different relationship between these two commodities? And that's, again, why I come back around to that point. When you talk about imports, you got to be careful, because it's too simple just to say imports. There's a lot going on here. Absolutely, and you have fraudulent domestic production too. You know,
I think the ratio's a lot finer.
8%. The recent fraud was 8%.
$71 billion.
Yep. In 2015 to 2016.
Or 71 million, or was it billion?
Oh,
I think it was 71 million.
It was 8% of the market was fraud.
It was huge.
In 2015 and 2016.
Well, and there's the one that came out earlier this week up in South Dakota, was it? That was fraudulent organic canola and flax. I think there's the import situation is more a symptom than it is a cause. And I'll get around to some of the finer points around that. Fraud hurts regardless of where it's coming from. The fraudulent imports, just like the fraudulent domestic, are taking advantage of the fact that the NOP is understaffed and they have limited ability to regulate some of this stuff. And they're taking advantage of the fact that if you can go and you can get $8 for $3 corn and nobody's there to catch you, there's a lot of people who are shady. They're going to do it. But again, my synopsis on imports is imports are a symptom, not a cause of the problem.
I would just add quickly, because I serve on the board of the Organic Farmers Association, which is a national organization. You know, under the new farm bill, we got $8 million, somewhere between $6 and $8 million into NOP for enforcement. So I think that factor is going to start trending down, because they're coming up with some pretty unique things and are adding quite a bit of staff. So
right.
I think you're going to see a lot more aggressive actions in the import fraud and domestic fraud scene, because they now have specifically some targeted money for that.
Yeah, and on the theme of that trend, the fraudulent issue trending down, we've already seen that. It's been in progress since 2017. 17 is when the fraud situation, the import fraud situation, really peaked. And through 18 and through 19, it's been on the decline. But I'll get down into the nitty-gritty of specifics on corn and soybean imports in just a little bit. So to sum up the import picture, and this is the point I was making before about imports being a symptom, not a cause. If you talk about what imports look like as a volume, even if we squeezed out every last ounce of fraud, what it comes down to is we imported almost $700 million of organic corn and soybeans over the 18-19 marketing year. Imported about 822,000 acres of organic crops. We only grew 639,000 acres of those crops. Almost all of that is soybeans. You can't just fix this by shutting off imports or getting rid of fraudulent imports. There's a significant gulf between what's being demanded and what can be produced. Not even talking about expanding the industry, just what can be produced in terms of the agronomical and the physical capacity of the industry that is causing this import situation. And then you have people who are taking advantage of it, and that's why you have fraud. Just like you have in the domestic market, you have fraud because people are taking advantage of it. So.
You got some questions here.
Yeah, yeah.
Just a newbie question.
Go for it.
If all of a sudden there was acres producing soybeans, mm-hmm. that would just simply displace, it would just further, it's more supply, so prices would fall, correct? I mean,
it's. It's, yeah. So his question is, if you just ratchet up acres, that just adds to supply and that reduces prices. And you're right. The other problem with that is, what else are you going to grow to triple your soybean acres? You're going to have to triple your rye. You're going to have to triple your everything else that you're growing as a rotational crop. These crops that already have pricing issues and they already have issues finding buying programs for them, where are you going to wind up then? Just adding soybean acres isn't enough to fix this. Yeah.
I mean, imports are going to be so much cheaper. Guys are going to gravitate. The buyers are going to gravitate to those. And even if there is U.S. production,
mm-hmm.
you're getting the amino acid. There's a lot more flexibility than that import. If the price dropped $3, it probably won't affect.
You guys are getting ahead of my slides. I'll get there. I'll get there. Yeah.
Do you know what the average cost of freight would be on a bushel of imported corn or beans?
I don't. I don't have any good freight numbers for it. I mean, you could probably talk to any of your grain buyers, and they would probably be able to tell you much better than I can what that freight's looking like. It's coming out of Latin America. It's coming out of India. It's coming out of the Black Sea. So basically, whatever your standard freight rates are for that. Coming back around, diving down into specific commodities, looking at organic corn, my graph does not match my bullet points, and that's because my graph is from October when I did an initial run at this, and my bullet points are from when I updated it. I'm halfway through doing a full update of our outlook. We'll come out with that in April, but the picture is somewhat still similar. Basically, coming out of last year, what we saw is weather hurt acres. You had issues planting, you had issues harvesting, and that cut acres and it cut yield. And so if you're looking at organic corn as a big picture in the United States, we're looking at about 4% less organic corn last year than what we had the year before. What that doesn't tell you, though, is we actually had about 13% more organic farms. So we have fewer acres coming off of more farms because we had planting and harvesting issues. So what does that tell you about the risk for acres and for production this year? If you have better planting, better harvesting, better yields, 13% more farms, you could pretty quickly see yourself winding up in a situation where you have 20% more organic corn by the time you get to harvest this year. Trying to give you a little bit closer of a regional picture, four-state region, kind of the area we are right now, pretty similar, pretty consistent with what we see on the national picture, which isn't surprising. Down about 265,000 bushels from where we were in the 18-19 marketing year, down about 4% on the supply side. So basically, the cliff note there is we're starting this year, marking the year off with tighter domestic supplies than we would have otherwise. Looking at imports. Now, drilling down into that corn import picture, and this is somewhat surprising, something that caught me off guard. One of the big things that we've seen go on with organic corn imports is if you look back at 15 and 16, it was almost all whole corn imports. Well, during 2017, we had the Washington Post piece, and that's when we really saw the crackdown on fraudulent imports from Turkey. And we saw imports from the Black Sea region in general fall off. One of the challenges that we have in this industry is data and being able to see things so that we can capture them, we can understand what's going on. We have, whenever you look at trade, basically trade's measured through these things called harmonized tariff codes that the U.S. government uses to monitor stuff that's being imported so they can assign tariffs. So organic corn and organic soybeans have these. Soybean meal does not, crack corn does not. So what we saw happen following 2017 is organic corn imports dropped off rapidly. Organic crack corn imports escalated significantly. So on paper, if all you look at is the corn imports for the U.S. and particularly from the Black Sea region, they went down. What we saw, though, is organic crack corn imports, and almost exclusively from Black Sea region, have escalated. So going into this year, if you would have asked me back in October what I expected, I would have said we would have had more organic whole corn and definitely more organic crack corn offsetting that reduced domestic situation. That didn't happen. So far, what we've seen is total imports through January of this year, they're down 17%. That's crack corn and whole corn. That doesn't mean a lot because you're talking about time of the year where imports are seasonally down because you come off of harvest. And I think that there was a lot of trepidation going into this past fall because nobody really knew what this crop was going to look like. So we have time to see that number reverse course. However, if you would have asked me, would imports be down through the first half of the marketing year? I said, no way. They're down 17%. That's just the brass tacks of it. Crack corn imports aren't down that much. They're down 3%. So it's really whole corn imports that we've seen get clipped. Looking at where our whole corn imports have fallen, Black Sea imports are down 31% from where they were last year. Last year, we saw Black Sea imports account for about 50% of our imports. This year, we're at about 41%. So if the Black Sea is really the problem, that problem has diminished. Because not only are we getting less corn in terms of imports, but even less of it's coming from that region. What we've seen, actually, offsetting that, is imports from Argentina. Argentina has come on as a major supplier. And essentially what you're seeing there is a lot of your operations that were basically working through a network of whoever they could get to export it, whatever deals they could establish in the Black Sea region. They've shifted their modus operandi. They're going to Argentina. They're establishing essentially their own operations, walking people through the certification process and building their own supply chain from Argentina, from Latin America. That's good because, quite frankly, it has a much higher degree of traceability and much lower risk of fraud. But it's bad because essentially you're setting yourself up now to have this dedicated supply chain coming into the U.S.
Question. Yeah.
Some of it does come down to, so it depends on who you ask. I mean, frankly, most of this is coming in as poultry feed, and cracked corn you can condense a little better in a container, and it works better as a poultry feed. And basically, if you think of it in that sense, then there's no reason for them not to crack the corn there, load it on a barge, ship it here.
So why are we getting docked for cracked corn if we got it in our system?
Because they want to crack it themselves. The other half of it being, though, it is the traceability issue. There are no codes for crack corn. And then the other thing is if you take corn, organic corn, and you ship it to Turkey and you crack it in Turkey, that is now organic crack corn from Turkey. The provenance now belongs to that country, not where the corn came from. So it definitely helps you conceal your country of origin on the corn itself. So there is that factor as well.
Do you think that's right?
I'm an economist. I don't deal in right and wrong. I just deal in numbers.
In your heart, you right or wrong.
I've got some more slides to get to, and I'm going to eat up all Michael's time. So,
well, there's a question for your next one.
I could get one more question. Yeah.
What do you think about this rainforest deforestation in Brazil? Is that all going to come into organic?
The rainforest deforestation? If you make it relevant, if the consumers care. It comes down to translating what does it mean to be organic and what is the value of buying that product and the process that it takes to make that product.
But it has to be on a label to know that that's verifiable process.
Yeah, well, it has to be on a label and that people have to understand what it means, both.
That's exactly right.
So wrapping all this up because I'm eating up all my time. Putting the supply and demand situation together for corn coming into this year. Frankly, it befuddles me. Imports are down a little bit. I know demand is slowing down a little bit, but production is off. So generally, you would expect that to create a tighter supply situation in the U.S., which should be supportive of prices. It's not what we've seen. If you look at the divergence between food grade and feed grade organic corn, you can see that food grade corn has definitely responded to the supply situation in the United States. The premium between the two has escalated significantly this past year. Food grade actually started picking up about the time we started to think that we're going to have a bad harvest, and since then it plummeted. There's a couple of things going on there that are kind of undercutting that price. Number one, we saw a huge amount of forward contracting in the spring, which basically crushed the forward market once you got around to harvest, or the spot market when you got to harvest. Two, there was a lot of hoarding grain going into this year, so we had bigger organic carryover stocks than we've seen in the past. That's purely anecdotal, though, because we have absolutely no way of measuring what that carryover stock number looks like. But it's consistent with what we've seen in prices. So I think what we saw was, number one, lots of forward contracting, two, more carryover, three, a lot of risk in terms of what supply was going to look like, and nobody was interested in buying corn over the fall. And that's, it shows up in prices. Do I think we'll get a rebound in prices this spring and into Q3? Yeah, people are going to need to fill those spot needs for animal feed, and that's going to have to add some demand to market. I would have told you prices would have been higher back in September too, so take everything I say with a grain of salt. But I think we've got to see a boost. I think the real risk is once we get to harvest. We know that demand number is slowing down, and we know that we've got more farms, and we know that, well, we don't know, but we hope we'll have better yields, better planting, and better harvesting. That could mean a lot more corn in the market by the time you get to harvest. And I've seen bids for new crop at $7.50. So that's the risk I see in the market right now. I can't tell you what it's going to be, but that's, I think, the primary risk, is that we'll have a lot more corn than what we've had in the past, and demand is not growing like it used to. And I think that creates the situation to have yourself a bearish market. Getting through soybeans. Soybeans is not quite as bad as corn. We didn't see quite as bad acreage loss. Yields were down. Overall, we're looking at production to be down about 4% year over year, kind of like what we saw in corn. Flying through these talking points, basically very comparable to what we see in the four state area here. We lost close to 50,000 bushels compared to where we were the previous year, down about 4%. So again, tighter domestic supply situation walking into this year. Looking at organic soybean imports. Soybean imports look a lot like corn. They kind of peaked around 2017 and they've fallen off since then. And what that is there's really two things going on there. Number one, we don't import from the Black Sea region. Number two, we don't import organic soybeans that much anymore. The market shifted. There's a fundamental problem with the soybean market, the organic soybean market in the U.S., where there's not a market for organic soybean oil. Most of your oil gets dumped in the conventional sector. It's going at 30, 35 cents a pound. Your meal's going for $7.50 or whatever you can get for it, but the oil's not. So if you're not getting value in the oil, you're not getting a premium in the oil, that premium's not getting bid back into the crusher, that premium's not getting bid back into the bean. And so as a result, and the other half of that is, as somebody who's buying meal, running a crushing facility, you don't want to deal with the oil. So what we've seen, kind of running through the high points, Argentina, just like we saw in corn, they're taking off. They've become the primary supplier. Canada just kind of continues as a mid-level supplier, just like we see in the crack corn, and actually more severe in the corn section. Black Sea imports of soybeans have dropped off. We actually finally imported some back in January, which is the first imports we've gotten from the Black Sea since June of last year. It's almost completely died off.
So I have a question about that. Is that, because I had this happen to me, dealt with the long-term buyer of my grain, made a phone call to them, I'm saying, like, dealt with this company for 7 to 10 years. Then they tell me, we no longer are buying that grain. And then they say, we're shipping it from overseas, like sea region.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, so, and the bottom line was this. We are no longer buying the grain. We built a $17 million factory in Bulgaria, and they're producing the oil. And once it's oil, it's oil.
Mm-hmm.
Like anything goes. Like,
yeah.
It's oil, it's oil. So is that the same with the beans?
Very comparable. You know, if you look at kind of following that line of thought, Black Sea, we're not importing from Black Sea. India's coming up, but overall we're down. This is soybean meal. Soybean meal has by far eclipsed anything we were doing in beans. And the reason is the reason the gentleman just pointed out right there, what you're able to do is you're able to go to India. Almost 90% of this, I think, so far this year is coming from India. What they've been able to do is you go to India and you can work with a crushing facility and their network of farmers who are de facto organic because they never adopted conventional practices. If within a year, you can be certified organic. So now you've taken this crushing facility and this network of farmers that was getting $300 a short ton for their meal and they were getting 30 cents or whatever it is for their oil. They don't care that they're not making a premium on oil. They weren't making it before, but now their meal goes for $700. It's win-win for them. You don't have to deal with the oil in the U.S. market. You're getting the meal supply that you need in the U.S. market. And you've got your steady supply again. Now, all of this sounds really, really bad. And it's a problem for U.S. markets. But again, this is a symptom of a bigger problem more than it is a cause of the problem. What this is a problem of is currently, we have a paradigm in the U.S. where our feed demand does not fit an organic production profile. Even if we wanted to bring all of that imports into the U.S. market, satisfy it from domestic production, doing it with soybeans is not the right way. You cannot escalate our organic soybean acres 300% without having significant ramifications for the U.S. organic sector. And that's why I say it's a symptom and not a cause of a problem. The problem is we have a disconnect in our markets between what fits an organic production profile and what is being used as the primary feed ration. And you're talking primarily about poultry lately. It's fixing that that fixes both of these things. Integrating things like more small grains and integrating beans and peas and lentils into your feed ration, especially peas, integrating peas or sunflower into your poultry feed rations, you can fit those into an organic crop rotation better than you can do cramming in more soybean acres. And by doing that, you don't have to escalate your soybean acres in the United States. You can raise the demand for the other crops that are already in your rotation, bid more value back into the farmers, and reduce your imports. It's not just a matter of shutting off imports or getting rid of fraud or putting on tariffs. None of that will fix it because we're not going to make that many soybean acres in the U.S., not for a long while, and we don't want to. It's a different problem than just imports. It's a demand problem. I got a little bit of time for any more questions. Yeah?
So along that line, what would you propose that we focus on as growers? A couple of years ago, I proposed to a feed mill about just what you just said, and I got very liberal encouragement.
Yeah, you know, I think his question is, what can you do as a grower to address that situation? You look at that 3% share that we have of food sales in the United States, and you're not going to move that needle significantly without engaging large producers who are used to working in the conventional space. You're just not. However, it's dangerous to become solely reliant on them for your growth. I think one of the biggest things that the organic industry, one of the biggest opportunities is internalizing that demand, internalizing the value add. Because whenever you take your grain, you sell it off to a feed mill and they sell it to a poultry farm or they sell it to dairy producers, they're making the value add off that grain. If you can establish smaller regional co-ops that have the production that's a part of their system, you know, you get 10 farmers in your area, you guys coordinate your crop rotations, you come up with your feed rations, and you produce the poultry yourself. You share the risk and the cost of the poultry operation and the revenue it generates. You internalize that demand. I think, and that's just one option, but I think that is the only real way to fix this. Is the other way is you could do it through legislative measures, forcing people to feed specific feed rations, but that's gonna be really, really, really hard. I think the real solution is taking that demand paradigm and internalizing it, which is really part of what organic is. It's about integrating livestock. It's about integrating soil preservation and crop rotation. It's about integrating things into your operation and not relying on external factors to make things work. It's internalizing that demand side. And I think that's one of the biggest ways that you can work to make this better. Yeah?
So do you recommend that people transition ground to organic grains right now?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, as bad as everything I just said up here is. You guys are still leaps and bounds above the conventional sector. And the reason you guys are doing better than the conventional sector is they lost sight of demand. They had 2005, 2006, 7, 8, all the way up to 2014. I used to do the conventional, and I went to John Deere in 2014. And I was talking to them, and we told them, you're going to have $4 corn within the next 5 years. Nope, $6 corn, that's the new paradigm. It's never dropping below 6. No, there's a fundamental lack of demand growth. You had biofuels, you had China switch over, you had some growth in Southeast Asia. Those things are done. You have no more demand growth in your pipeline. Without demand growth, you got acres increasing, you got yields increasing, you got more grain, you got lower prices. That's what's gonna happen. Nope, $6 corn. It's at 350 now. So I think we're still doing great. We're still doing much better than the conventional, but we need to keep sight of where we need to be to keep this thing growing.
Skirting of the rule process in organic dairies, and we now have 10,000 cow organic dairies, and it's decimating the organic feed industry in Wisconsin as a case in point, but because there's a skirting of these rules, so all of us in the whole organic industry really need to be pushing everybody for enforcement of the rules that encourage regional development and regional animal production. It's a real dangerous situation going on right now. So.
Yeah.